The third plenary session of the conference and final plenary session is on promoting innovation and disruption in the fourth industrial revolution. Moderating this session is Ms. Randhula De Silva, CEO of Hatch Sri Lanka, Professor Sachin Chaturvedi, Director General of RIS India, Mr. Asif Ibrahim, Vice Chair, New Age Group, Bangladesh, Dr. W. A. Wijewardena, former Deputy Governor, Central Bank of Sri Lanka, Mr. Pranjal Sharma, Economic Analyst and Author, India, Ms. Lakmini Wijesundera, CEO, IronOne Technologies, Sri Lanka, Ms. Tehani Renganathan, Strategic Transformation Lead, MAS Holdings, Sri Lanka. I cordially invite the moderator and panelists to please take their seats on stage.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. What an absolute pleasure to be moderating the closing plenary with such a vibrant panel sitting with me, representing experts from the region. And not only that, but from very diverse sectors, policy, economics, and also private sector. A very warm welcome to the panelists who've joined here today to discuss the very broad topic that we have been set with, which is promoting innovation and disruption on 4IR. The rise of emerging technologies, as we've discussed during the past 2 days, AI to IoT, to deep learning, machine learning, all of this gives us a lot of interesting opportunities to tackle some of the large scale systemic challenges we have here in South Asia. And I think we can, because also our young population is very adaptive across all spectrums on all these emerging technologies and have already created a very large, educated labor market in Sri Lanka, in South Asia. But having said that, there's a gap in terms of systemic policies and structures that are given and facilitated by public sector as facilitating agents. And to facilitate the innovation that's driven by private sector and startup sector as a whole. And how do we bridge this gap through medium and short-term policies is what we would like to explore at the discussion today with this very vibrant panel that we have that represents the public sector as well as the private sector across the region. So to open the discussion, I turn to my left, Professor Sachin Chaturvedi, very pleasure to have you here, sir. Would you like to open with your opening remarks on how we approach this topic, and then we'll move on to double tap later.
Thank you. Thanks, Randhula, for this opportunity and for getting this vibrant panel together. Everybody is very closely following fourth industrial revolution as we are discussing it. And I'm so glad that this panel is the last one in the last 2 days when we have been discussing the sectoral imperatives of this industrial revolution. I think this morning we had two very important points made in the first plenary this morning. I remember Dr. Song from ADB, who mentioned that whatever technology is coming in, it has to have impact on quality of life. And I think that's the bottom line for us to assess what disruption, what contribution a technology is making if it is not changing quality of life. So that, I think, is the bottom line with which we have to begin. The morning panel also tried to take us out from this binary of labor saving and labor augmenting. So that, I think, is another sort of benchmark that we should keep in mind when we are talking about such a rapid transformation, disruption, and the way new technologies are being introduced. And I think South Asia, given the fact that is the youngest part of any continent, most populous part of the world, where development and development imperatives are huge, spillover impacts are huge. So this is one region where we would have to see technological change from these two processes: A, quality of life, and B, impact on labor. What kind of issues are there? And from that point of view, I just would have 5 points to make in next 5 minutes. I would be very quick to finish that. Of course, the change that we are going to expect through this technology and its introduction is the digitization. And that's my point number one. That with digitization, you're going to bring in several actors out of the informal to formalization, and that would have its own changes. The ways that would digitization bring in would be sometimes unanticipated, sometimes they may go in completely different and new ways, but we would have to see how that pace of adoption of technology, it would be even. It is inclusive. It is not excluding people. So if it is at an uneven level, it would create social disruptions, and those social disruptions would be difficult to cope up with, and that's where you require skills. You require capacity for people to absorb and cope up with those changes, and that's where ability, agility, and preparedness, these three are extremely important. Yesterday, Swarnim Wagle, I think very, very important point he made in terms of preparedness of South Asian countries to cope up. And I think that's where the resilience power comes in, that's where the agility comes in, and that I think is very important. And my third point is, if you see the latest WIPO report, the World Intellectual Property Organization's 2019 report, it brings out AI-related research, the institution building, the adoption that is required, and how regulatory architecture is to be addressed. So these four dimensions of management of AI, I think, are extremely important. One of the questions that you mentioned in the note to speakers is about national initiatives that we have. In case of India, I would like to mention that Niti Aayog is the central pivot on this, but DST, the Department of Science and Technology, has introduced what is called as the Interdisciplinary Cyber Physical Systems, which is going to provide the lead on this. The Department of Biotechnology has already launched Artificial Intelligence, Genomics, and Health. So that's the niche they have identified. METI has identified NAIC, the National Artificial Intelligence Center, as the lead, and NIC has established what is called a Center of Excellence in Artificial Intelligence. Among the academic institutions, three institutions have excelled. DRDO, for instance, has established what is called as Center for AI and Robotics. IIT Madras is our lead on several sectors, particularly in the health sector, and they are also working with the Robert Bosch Center, which has now stepped into the cyber security and also the security implications of artificial intelligence. And then we have, of course, the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, which has strengthened their program. And then are some of the sectors where you see there is a recent survey that IIM Bangalore has just finished, and they have done that of around 350 Indian firms which have adopted AI. And you would be glad to know that around 240 of these firms are using AI in five different sectors of manufacturing, fintech, health, agriculture, and education. And among the actors, you find the banks, the firms, and also startups. So an ecosystem now is emerging, which is preparing Indian economy for any possible disruption that would be there, or they are part of the disruption process itself. And that's where the absorptive capacity of the economy is multiplying. Now, several of the institutional initiatives have also been taken. Since I'm on the board of the Reserve Bank of India, we have ourselves launched several initiatives in terms of building institutional capacity to contribute IT-related capabilities of the banks and banks to consumer interaction. Because that is largely, as you know, in India, we have the public sector banks as the main sort of provider of the banking services. So capacity of them and with their consumers, I think, would be an extremely important dimension of the financial inclusion program that the government of India has launched. And that is providing and preparing, I would say, all the institutions, the citizens, in terms of a regulatory architecture which is providing facilitation to innovation, but also preparing the stakeholders for any kind of disruption that may come in with the introduction of these technologies at various different levels. Also important is the regulatory architecture in terms of legislations, and that I think India is trying to address. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you also for sticking to your time and also giving so much of insights as to the topics that you're covering as India as a whole and that we would return to in the next round to touch upon. I think I wouldn't go with the order that we are seated with, but by the sector to also create more of interesting discussion. So that gives me a natural shift to you, Dr. Wijewardena, if you'd like to contribute with your remarks, also representing the public sector of Sri Lanka as the former government.
Thanks, Randhula, and there are two things that we'll have to remember because this fourth industrial revolution is coming, number one. Number two,
it is immensely disruptive. So as a result, Sri Lanka will have to prepare itself to meet it without incurring a substantial social or economic cost to its society. So unfortunately for us, unlike India, we are not ready to face it so far. There has not been any roadmap that has been prepared by us in order to go through this successfully. So it's a matter for us to take notice of what is happening in the rest of the world and how the fourth industrial revolution might affect Sri Lanka's economic structure, because presently our economy is basically based on the garment industry, apparel industry. And apparel industry is the one which is going to suffer heavily out of the fourth industrial revolution, because the apparels are the ones which can be automated easily without any issue, and the robotization program, the artificial intelligence, and also the machine learning are now being used by apparel manufacturers in an extensive way, so that the previous advantage that Sri Lanka had as a result of the low wages is no longer with us. So presently what we experience, Randhula, is that the apparel industry is now going back home to the Western countries. Usually we find that it's being re-established in UK, re-established in Europe, re-established in North America. At the same time, they have chosen some bordering countries where they would be able to set up the factories, which we call nearshoring. So so in the future, within the next 5-year period, probably Sri Lanka will have the major disruption to its economy as a result of the ongoing fourth industrial revolution process. So we have to be ready for that right now. And what I would suggest is that there are about, say, 300,000 people who are employed in the apparel industry directly, and there are more than 500,000 indirectly. So all these people might lose their jobs, and it might lead to a huge social instability in Sri Lanka unless we take notice of it right now. So the roadmap, which has to be prepared by the government with the private sector support, will have to take into account this factor, and it has to retrain the workers in the apparel industry to become partners of the fourth industrial revolution which is coming there. So it means the re-education, relearning, and also going back to school. So so one important aspect that I would like to bring out here is that there are certain firms in Sri Lanka which have tried to penetrate the global market through the new technological innovations. So one is, because I have been to many of these firms, one firm is this Mass Matrix located in Tulhiriya Fabric Hub, and they are producing the canvas for Nike shoes which are being manufactured in a factory in Vietnam. And they have got the technology from Nike, and it's a very unique technology which is a secret which they don't want to share with anyone. And they have become they are supplying about 20% of the world market requirements of the Nike shoes. So another one is this Harness Lanka, which is producing the sensors for the airbags in motor cars, which is again having about 20% global market share. Mm. And so what I would suggest is that the future roadmap that we are, should produce, we must be very happy about the two firms. But those two firms are not sufficient. We must have a critical pool of new innovators who will take into account the ongoing fourth industrial revolution. And that critical pool has to be re-established in Sri Lanka with the support of the private sector. And this is the topmost priority for the presidential hopefuls who are seeking the position in the 2019 presidential election. And we must be able to convey this message to them that unless they come up with the roadmap to take Sri Lanka to future, what would happen is that Sri Lanka's economic growth is slowing down right now, and we are in the rock bottom level. The best projections have revealed that we may not be able to make a recovery within the next 2 to 3 year period. And we might be a laggard in South Asian region when countries like, say, Bangladesh, even Maldives are now moving ahead of us. So this is the message that I want to deliver here.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Wijewardena. I think as my role of moderator, I also don't want to be the devil's advocate, but I'm going to step out a little bit of that comfort zone and be the devil's advocate anyway. I would like to beg to disagree with you on one point, to say that I don't think the future of FOIR or the leash of FOIR relies with corporates anymore. And when you ask me the question, why would anybody want to support entrepreneurs or do some activities around supporting entrepreneurs, I think the answer is that. Because the future really is in the hands of really young companies who are going to make the change that the South Asian countries' governments have not been able to create and harness as policy-making institutes so far. So with that, I would like to turn to the disruptor, if I may call, in the panel, who initiated the selfie itself, Pranjal Sharma. I think you have some candid insights to share with us.
Right.
To change
the... Thank you. I think this is a fantastic panel, most balanced, and I'm glad to see startups and entrepreneurs on this panel, which I thought was missing in some of the panels earlier, because I think that's important. I'm not going to speak about India. I'm from India, but I'd like to speak about the relationship between entrepreneurs, government, policymakers, academia. The first thing I'd like to say, if you're looking at promoting disruption and innovation first, disruption is not a bad word. It's essential, it's essential, it's essential. You've got to have that. If you don't have it, you're a dying society, you're a dying economy. Second, for the government, if you want to look at innovation and disruption, get out of the way. Don't stand in the way. Don't regulate, let things flow. Come in if there's a problem, but don't try to think that you know better than what's happening in technology or in the industry, because trust me, even those in the technology and the industry don't know what's going on. So if you try to put rules about what's going to happen, you know, if somebody had put some rules saying that, well, let's have a messaging app which is better than an SMS or a text message, but let's say that, look, don't make any calls through it, and let's not put any pictures on it, and let's try not to have people talking through it, then you wouldn't have had WhatsApp. Right now, tell me how many of us can live without WhatsApp today. It could be dead in the next few years, we don't know. But the fact is, there was no rule, and therefore it could come up. The second important thing is that all of us, like me, gray hair, think that we know everything, but we learned, we studied a degree 30 years ago, and we're still living off it. And I'm sure most of us have not been to a classroom in the last 5 years, except the millennials sitting at the back, and which is the other point, all the young folks who are digital natives are sitting at the back, and all of us who are losing our hair are sitting in the front. But the fact is that whatever we've learned in the last 20 years, whatever we've done, does not matter anymore. It's not relevant. Everything that we have been doing has to be relearned. And that's what a couple of my senior panelists said today. And that's important, not just in skilling terms, but in approach and the processes that we have. Successful entrepreneurs today are uneducated. They don't have a successful background. They didn't come up with, you know, 10 years of doing this and 20 years of doing that. They just had an idea. They worked with it. So I'll close on this, and I have some, you know, more points to speak on. The launching something exciting is different from running it. So I'm not saying that experience is not important, but let people launch, create, and then the experienced people can come in and running it. And if you look at some of the storied companies like Google and others, the owners who created it are not necessarily those who are running it. So we have to keep that aspect in mind. Let minds completely innovate. And you know, it's innovation is not just about a young person, it's about a young-minded person. So I can leave a 25-year-old job, go out and start something else because my company didn't allow me to do it. I have a great idea. The company was just too old or boring to take a risk. For the policymakers and for the ecosystem, I think the question is that the problem statement itself begins to be a problem. You know, is restricted. So if you say that I want to make my road safer or I want to make a car better, that's not the question. Question is, how can I get to where I want to be faster in the most efficient way? Now, if you frame a question like that, you get an innovative answer. If you say, tell me how best to put a nail into the wall, you will get an answer, use a better hammer or maybe there should be plaster on the wall, etc. But if you say, I want to decorate this room, right? Somebody will say, why don't you use an augmented reality piece? Why don't you project this? Why don't you hang something else? So the framing of the problem for the civil society, by the regulators, for improving everything is very important. I think two last points, since I have 2 minutes to go. One, the concept of employment, and you know, there's been a lot of conversation about employment and jobs. If you look back at it, and all of you are far more educated than I am with PhDs, that it is rooted in the 18th century when you had white-collar workers, blue-collar workers going, fixing an assembly line, coming back home, and then you know you created that only to make sure that you knew how they were working. Why should that concept of employment be valid today? I need work, I need livelihood, I need to be able to earn my living. That's the concept, right? Now, whether I have a job and a piece of paper or a degree shouldn't matter. My skills and my ability to deliver a solution should matter. So it's not just about reskilling. We have to rethink the way things are completely. Final point on the government. I think government is important to the extent today that government should have a simple role. I began by saying that get out of the way, don't regulate. The only thing that the government should watch out for is monopolistic behavior. If you prevent very successful companies from dominating and becoming monopolistic, that's not a good thing because it kills innovation. So anybody who becomes too big, break it up. As they shatter, something new will come up and innovation will thrive. Thank you.
Thank you, Pranjal. Thank you for adding such lively insights into this discussion. With that, I move to Lakmini, representing the private sector, to add in her comments as well.
Sure. Thank you, Randhula. So as Randhula mentioned, my angle would be the private sector as a global entrepreneur, specifically in the ICT sector. So having said that, I'm going to divide my discussion into two parts. I'm just going to share why and what this means to me, or how I observed it, and then thereafter share some of the how we should get about this. So having said that, talking about the private sector and the ICT sector, really speaking, in a country like Sri Lanka, which is an Asian country, South Asian country. Sri Lanka is a small country. And if you take South Asia itself, through my encounters with various countries and various meetings that we've had, we don't particularly have this great brand, let's say, for IT or ICT for that matter. So for example, if I were from the US or European country, immediately they would accept us as being great in IT or innovation. So along with this fourth industrial revolution, it's really the fourth industrial revolution from the way I look at it. It's not just digitizing, digitalizing, automation. We've been doing that for like 30 years now. And throughout my lifetime, from the time I got into the IT industry, after working, etc., becoming an innovator, we've been still working on legacy technology. There's still a lot to go on that, but this is something different. So when it came to the, let's say, the third industrial revolution, computing coming in, or electricity coming in, or steam coming in, countries like Sri Lanka or countries in the South Asian region probably didn't have this equal opportunity. Because once the revolution happens, you're either a privileged country or an underprivileged country. That's kind of how I see it. And this is kind of a monumental opportunity to jump from one side to the other. And the opportunity and the equal opportunity, and I would like to call it equal because internet is there. Even the rural person in a place we call Dehiyattakandiya, which is a faraway place in Sri Lanka, he has the same opportunity to access internet, Google, and find out things which we couldn't have in those other revolutions. So that is why it's so important that we don't miss it. And we kind of separate it out from technology in general. Because these technologies, from AI to Internet of Things, the big data, the blockchain, those things are very specific. And I believe that even myself, for that matter, so if I talk a little bit about myself, so I'm into the IT sector. We think we are doing great innovative work. We are called innovators. But suddenly, when you really think of it, the amount of work we do on these technologies is very limited. We think maybe the demand is not there yet. That's from our angle, because there's so much to do on the legacy work. But really, if we are going to walk the talk, I believe myself too, we are somewhat to blame. The IT sector, we ourselves, it's not just the policymakers or anybody like that, but we ourselves have to embrace this thing and realize that we have to take a big chunk of these technologies, kind of make it happen. Take it out to the, because there are two types of stakeholders in this. There's the consumers, and those are the banks and the corporates and utility, telecom, all these institutions. And then there's us, the enablers. So the enablers have to educate and make sure that the consumers understand that they have to take this up, because if the privileged countries pretty much take this up, and it's happening now, if you look at the statistics, the privileged countries, that's where the companies are coming from IT perspective. If we don't jumpstart this, we're going to miss this. And after we miss it, there's no point. So that's really my take on this particular topic. It's quite distinct to standard digital technology or getting automated. And if I talk about the product that I do, so as I mentioned, we talk about it as innovative, but we're still doing legacy. We did some AI work. It was greatly taken, in Australia and some of the other countries. People loved it. But I honestly am embarrassed to say that we didn't take it forward to huge commercial work. And in fact, this is something, after doing some research for this particular program, I felt I have a duty for the country and for South Asia, for that matter, that we have these opportunities. So having said that, from an IT sector point of view, it's not all bad. There are pockets like Slascom, for example. They're doing a lot of AI awareness. They've done forums and things like that. But these are pockets. And pockets of people trying to make this sound important or make this realization of being important. Then there's ICTA. We've been fortunate to have an organization, ICT agency, since the late 90s. Which has national policies and national plans. There's a new one coming up in 2019, in fact. And we are hopeful that these technologies will come in a strong way. But having said that, this is the environment we are in. And I really feel as a person or a professional or an entrepreneur in the ICT field that we have a responsibility to, and then also drive the policymakers, because policy itself is not going to really do much unless we as a community, the consumers, that's the banks, etc., as well as the enablers get onto it. So a little example I had of this is, I'm sure you all know about this, like Switzerland, how it took Bitcoin or the blockchain. They legalized it, and I've seen a lot of videos. I haven't actually experienced it, but they're actually using it. Now, that kind of bold steps will have to be done by South Asia, because otherwise we're just watching that, and it's going to pass. The story should be ours. It shouldn't be, you know, another European country or the US countries, because there's nothing really stopping us. We also can do this in this era. So having said that, I have a very interesting saying by Henry Ford that I really love. So he says, whether you think you can or whether you think you cannot, you are right. So thank you.
Thank you, Lakmini. Thank you for that perspective. Overall, I think be it policy, be it private sector, wherever you may represent, overall it really boils down to mindset. And the pockets that Lakmini spoke of, SLASCOM to ICTA, we are lucky as Sri Lanka to have those organizations as lobbies or whistleblowers or people who really put a spotlight onto these topics that we really need to focus on as public sector in terms of giving enabling policies, and also as private sector to support them to come out of their comfort zones and really embrace the technologies as their own. So with that, I would like to move on to, I have two more representatives in the panel, both from the private sector. I'll first move to Ibrahim from Bangladesh, Asif Ibrahim. You would speak about also the private sector and also a bit about the public-private sector partnerships, I suppose.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank Institute of Policy Studies for inviting me to talk about this very important topic for IR from the perspective of the private sector of Bangladesh. On one hand, we are very excited because we see a couple like Rini Ahsan and Rakib Raza. We never heard of them, but they've set up a company called Planetary Limited, who are manufacturing commercial robots. And they are doing 3D concrete printing, and they have exported 11 robots to South Korea. So it just had come out of the blue, and we are all very excited, very, very happy. We have a pool of thousands of freelancers who are working with Odesk and other things. Everything is hunky-dory. We have 4,554 union digital centers, as was mentioned by my colleague from the PMO. But at the same time, as the governor mentioned, and also Sachin mentioned, the social disruption. I think that is where we need to focus on, especially from Bangladesh perspective, because as I think Mustafiz Bhai also mentioned in the morning, key sector of Bangladesh for exports, which is ready-made garments, contributes to 83% of the foreign exchange earning of the country. And majority of the workers who are women in a country, in a Muslim country like Bangladesh, you have to understand that. The social implication of job displacement will be enormous. In 2013, we used to have 5.7 million of them working. In 2018, it has already come down to 4.2 million. But not because of 4IR, it's because of the driving down of prices. So the companies had to resort to new innovative ideas of driving down costs. So obviously, increasing efficiency means, you know, getting rid of all the workers, which maybe perhaps they didn't need. Then again, I also see a lot of donors who are involved in many of these, along with the governments, many of these skills development projects in the region. Asian Development Bank has got a $50 million project with the Ministry of Finance of Bangladesh and 7 or 8 sectoral associations for skill development projects. And since I've joined into the board of BGMA, I went into depth of these projects, and I found out that we have 71 training centers across the country. And we are providing training for manual operations of sewing operations and this, that, and the other. And I found out that what they're teaching there, the courses, the contents, the instructors, and what's required in the industry now, there's a huge gap of difference. So we need to address the core issues of all these brilliant projects that we have in this, in my country, and as well, I'm sure in yours as well. Where is the connect between what's the requirement of the industry and what's being delivered? So I think this is where collaboration between the government,
the civil society and the private sector needs to come together to ensure that that happens. We've just signed an MOU with the A2I, access to information, and through that we are thinking of taking their assistance for reskilling and upskilling the RMG sector job demands, which would meet the 4IR criteria, using local technology and tools, which is also very important because in 30,000 taka now, this new, in the innovation lab of the Science Museum, which is driven by A2I, they've been able to come up with a 3D printer, which produced an artificial limb, as was shown before. So these are all, this is also quite exciting, but we need to look at developing innovation challenge funds. Funding is going to be a huge requirement for this big initiative. Promote technology-driven work and the education system, which you know across the region and also in Bangladesh, which is so outdated. How is it going to meet the need of what we are going to face as a challenge coming forward? Fashion brands, they have taken some new initiatives. They're adapted digital technologies like computer-aided design, digital data, artificial intelligence for tech design and sourcing, 3D rendering, fashion design in VR and all that. All of this is very good. I would like to end by quoting a statistics of the global apparel manufacturing market. The total global apparel manufacturing market is $785 billion in the year 2016. And the Asia-Pacific markets accounted for 61% of that market value. China, $140 billion plus. Hence, majority of the workforce, again, I would like to end with that, majority of the workforce in this region will be displaced. Most of them are women. How we are going to provide them with alternative jobs is the challenge. And that's where we need to pull our resources together, join our hands, and see how we can cope with this potential looming threat that's enveloping us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your insights. With that, I move to Tehani, representing the private sector, a very innovative company of the private sector, MAS Holdings in Sri Lanka. I think we also have a huge fan base here at the panel of your company. If you could elaborate a little bit on your perspective as well.
Thank you, Randhula. And I think it's interesting, being the last one on the block for this segment, I think what I'd really like to do is articulate a private sector perspective and then touch on examples from companies like MAS to try and enrich the conversation as well. But I think overall, even within MAS, within the industry, when we start talking about the fourth industrial revolution, the concept itself is very overwhelming. We think of self-driving cars, artificial intelligence, supercomputers, and the list simply goes on. What it really means is that we are surrounded by mammoth change taking place around us, and even that at an exponential rate. So we live in an era which has great promise, but also great peril. Great promise because now organizations are better able to dramatically change their productivity. We're able to get billions more people onto connected networks, but also challenging because if organizations are unable to adapt, if governments are unable to harness the collective strength of these technologies, manage and regulate it, then therein lies the problem that we're facing. So I think the conversation around how we, as organizations, industries, and countries, strategize around adopting and harnessing these technologies within the economic trends that we are facing today, that is the important question. So I'd like to really start by highlighting three macroeconomic trends which I think are affecting industries across the spectrum and very realistically the apparel industry as well. We are seeing a rapidly changing consumer market that is really increasing the level of unpredictability in our industry. We used to be blessed with a rather predictable seasonal demand pattern. Today that is fast eroding. We are faced with rising costs, which is further eroding the competitive advantages we as an Asian region had. And this is putting immense cost pressures, especially on the manufacturing industry. And finally, we are facing increasing global competitiveness and connectedness. So on the one hand, this connectivity is giving us access to more information and more knowledge. On the other hand, it is creating an increasingly connected consumer and also an increasingly demanding consumer, which we have to now respond to. So the overarching question is, how do we respond to these macroeconomic changes in the light of the fourth industrial revolution and convert them into opportunities? I think Lakmini touched on it briefly when you said it, the answer lies in the transition between the third industrial revolution, which is the advent of the computer and information technology, and the fourth industrial revolution, which is data, diagnostics, digital, right? It depends on how we as organizations and industries use this data, building off of our existing IT systems, legacy systems, if it may, to be able to take on the future. And that is really where it will filter out the leaders from the laggards of the future. So I'd like to very quickly double-click on just a few examples on how MAS specifically and companies within the apparel industry are responding to some of these trends. If we take the example of unpredictability and rising cost pressures, we have found that one of the answers may lie in the fundamental principles of Industry 4.0. And the underlying premise here is that you create access to real-time data to decision makers to be able to analyze and derive insights which can now optimize your processes, drive agility, speed, flexibility, and really drive that across the value spectrum. So one thing we are doing internally and we're looking at it is really how we enhance the human-machine interface by using sensor technology. What this does is it helps us get access to data at the point of interaction through which we can then derive insights and then optimize our resources, make our processes more dynamic in how we respond to the changing market dynamics. We are also looking at enhancing and scaling digital platforms to create more connectivity across the value chain, from your shop floor, from your sourcing, from your front end, and hopefully someday right to the very end of the consumer. So when the consumer makes a purchase, we react on this end, and that will be dramatic change. The second point I'd like to touch on is how companies are really investing in the future of their industry. We are actively investing in the future of apparel, and we did this about 5 years ago, where we took the approach where part of our investment portfolio would be invested in what we call weak signals. These are signals that could potentially disrupt or revolutionize our industry. And an example is how MAS invested in the wearable technology platforms of today. And thank goodness it all spanned out. And today, we are one of the largest smart apparel manufacturers in the world. But if you look back at why we took this journey, we took it for three reasons. We said we wanted to redefine and create exponential value between the human and the clothing interface. We said we want to now extend the apparel S-curve and look at what is next. And we also said while creating, we wanted to create a platform that could help us collect and derive data-driven insights, which could someday optimize and enhance the human condition. And we are seeing applications even in the healthcare space through this. I think the third point, which I think many people touched, is the point about talent, actively investing in talent and ecosystems. As the fourth industrial revolution will undoubtedly revolutionize the job market, it's likely to do it in two ways. It will definitely create new categories of talent and capability, but at the same time, it will also help us complement and enhance our existing labor to really make them more productive, to give them their jobs more meaning as we automate repetitive mundane tasks and really create work-life balance. I think someone mentioned quality of life and how we bring that to our employees. Just very briefly, I'd like to touch on three interesting models that we have adopted in the industry. In order to bring in in-source talent, we've looked at creating hubs across the world with an open innovation platform where we collaborate with networks across the world to bring in talent, expertise, and technology so that we take our innovations to market faster, incubation to market faster. We're looking at how we bring in entrepreneurs in residence, where you take people out of their daily routine work and you augment them with entrepreneurs from around the world to really give them the access, the knowledge, the mentorship, and the guidance they need to take them forward. And finally, we are looking at rethinking the future of work, how we rethink culture, how we rethink of the IT employee interface, how we look at flexibility, giving them quality of work, quality of life, and really enhancing that experience overall. So I would like to sum up by just touching on the three themes I touched on. How do we leverage data to optimize and drive agile decision-making? how do we leverage global interconnectedness to propel innovation and be relevant? And finally, how do we actively invest in creating the workforce of the future? Thank you. Thank you, Dehani. With that, we've, I think, heard from all panelists and the diverse insights they bring on to this discussion, which definitely will make the rest of our conversation very lively. So I would like to ponder the panel again with a very short question. With all of your insights coming onto the platform, it's evident that 4IR definitely has a lot of potential in being a catalyst of growth for South Asia as a whole, but are we prepared, is a question. And also, who is going to drive this change of innovation? Who's going to be the executioner, is a question. And also, 4IR is not just all these technologies that we're talking about, but 4IR has also touched real life sectors. Education, healthcare, finance, all these sectors are now touched by 4IR itself. And how do we then, as an emerging region, balance and embrace these technologies and also manage and optimize the disruption that it would bring to us? So this is a question that I would like to throw at you. You would be very kind to take 2 to 3 minutes to address this, and then we will have enough time to open the floor for questions coming from the audience as well. I would first like to go with you, Sachin, same order that we followed.
Thank you, Radhila. I think I must remind yesterday what Ratnakar Adhikari very rightly summarized when he was moderating a panel in terms of how the fourth industrial revolution has three features, and I think those features should guide us in terms of the idea and imagination. So his points were speed, scope, and scale. So speed, scope, and scale should give you a sort of response to the question that you have posed to the panel now in terms of how we would be responding, who would be responding. Let me take you back at this point to the suggestion that I made in terms of regulatory architecture. I should not be naming countries, but there are three countries that have felt already the tremors of artificial intelligence and related technological excellence in terms of governance. The banking system came to a halt in two countries on instruction of another mega economy when SWIFT stopped working for those two economies. And we know what important SWIFT is in terms of banking architecture for interbank transfers, and particularly in those economies where they are fully automated. So with digitization, governance, and control of some mega economies on such global public goods that have been created earlier is a case in point. Second experience that came to these two countries was in terms of suspension of operations by MasterCard and Visa card. You know how economies which are digitized are dependent on operations of these companies. Not all countries have capabilities and ability to have their own gateways. And these two countries suffered this blow of withdrawal of digitized services on which they were dependent. So much so that in one of them, the fuel station stopped working because they were linked up with these cards. So we are not talking of 10 years down the line. We are talking of what is happening right now. Countries are facing that challenge. So saying that government should be out and private sector should prevail, simply not going to be the case. 1991, when India embarked on economic reforms, we were told by so-called managers of the structural adjustment program that let the government be out and private sector would take care of the research of the institutions. Look at what happened to India's agriculture research and innovation system. We have gone down the drain, and it is now the private sector that is dominating, a sector that came out with the World Bank support in 1954 of India's seed sector, was completely ruined, and we are dependent on BT cotton and a couple of other varieties in that sector because of the private sector. So I think technology cannot be just left on its own. Government and government's role in terms of, as Pranjal very rightly said, in terms of monopolistic, but I say it is more than monopolistic. It is about social and public interest. It is about the way it is to be governed, and it is also about how early starters in the technology and early arrivals, those who are leveraging this with path-dependent development models, are ahead of several of other actors. My institution has just come out with a paper Dr. Amit Kumar has done on robotization in China's textile sector. And I'm very glad that Asif Bhai has highlighted this issue. We are concerned in terms of China's investment in agriculture sector, in textile sector in specific countries where automation would be promoted through robots. 46% of Chinese textile production now is with robots. If that comes to countries where textile is the main sector, what would happen to the cost of production? What would happen to the labor market, the binary that I referred to of labor saving or labor augmenting? What would happen to those questions? These are live questions right now, and state's role is very important.
Thank you very much. Thank you for emphasizing the issue that we are actually trying to address today of us all working in silos of excellence. I think there was a very nice comment this morning at one of the panels where a speaker spoke, quoted, we all work in islands of excellence in oceans of status quo. So this is exactly what we are trying to really discuss here and explore how we actually connect the dots between government, public sector, and the private sector that's driving innovation and wants to have it happen fast. And how do we do it in a sustainable way is what we're trying to explore. With that, I would like to move to Dr. Wijewardena, if you'd like to comment for 2 minutes.
Well, I think I might disagree with the Indian experience a little, because in a country like Sri Lanka, the government has no capacity to drive any innovation in Sri Lanka because our research institutions are understaffed, under-resourced, and as a result, they are not in a position to come up with any innovative research in Sri Lanka. Even the universities, we have the same problem. But I might say the driving of the innovation should be done by people like Lakmini here, who have to take the country forward with new innovations, which have to be facilitated by a facilitating role played by the government, like the central bank's fintech sandbox that they have developed here in the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, where they have permitted all the commercial banks to play around and come up with regulatory matters. And as a result, the commercial banks are now in a position to come up with their new innovations in the financial technology industry. But the disruptive part is definitely there's a role for the government, because the social cost arising from disruption cannot be made by the private sector alone. It's a matter for the government to take into account what would happen to our workforce, what kind of skills that they have to develop in the future in order to remain relevant and remain useful in the market. And that part should come from a massive mega human resource plan to be introduced by the government. So it's a collaborative exercise with the private sector and the government.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Wijewardena. Lakmini, would you like to add to this?
Yeah, sure. My thoughts are somewhat aligned. However, talking from the again from the point of view of the ICT sector, when Dr. Wijewardena mentioned about the textile industry that potentially can get harmed by this whole innovation coming in, my understanding is actually it's the reverse for the IT sector, because IT sector can boom really in this South Asian region due to the exact same reason, unless we don't take action. So therefore, to some extent, as I mentioned, we all have to also understand the urgency to be the first through the door, really. Because if we don't, and we sort of watch for US or Europe to do these things, by then the glamour and the whole thing is gone, and we'll never get a chance. But in terms of us actually doing it, since I've been involved in some of these initiatives from SLASCOM ICTA, and I see Modsit also here. There's a lot of effort to try and get even the smaller policies, I'm talking even legacy policies in, and there's a lot to be done. And the focus here really is the fourth industrial revolution. Now that's gonna be a catastrophic good or bad for our region, and it shouldn't be judged by just general technology, which we're all used to. So that's my take on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Lakmini. Mm-hmm. I would turn to Pranjal, if you'd like to add 2 minutes or less, and then we'll open to the audience after the other two speakers. Sure.
So, you know, what's fascinating today is that technology, if you remember all of us sitting in South Asia in the 70s, 80s, we used to go to all these developed countries and say, can you please give us your technology? And I'm sure all of you have been involved, some of you would have been involved in technology transfer packs and things like that. Today you don't do that. Why? Because the fourth industrial revolution technologies are open, they're egalitarian. Everybody has equal access. Nobody controls artificial intelligence. Drone technology is open for everybody. You can create anything out of blockchain. So what is stopping us from doing what we want? So local solutions are the way ahead for each country. You don't have to depend on the Western technological prowess anymore. And I think that's a fascinating and a fundamental shift which is happening the world over. In any case, because of the demographics, the gravity of the center of economic gravity is shifting to our part of the world. Add this a layer of technology which is allowing us to do whatever. So, you know, entrepreneurs like you, Randhula, and Lakmini, and you, all of you can do things that the West doesn't understand. Yesterday, Minister De Silva talked about PickMe, which is giving great competition to Uber, right? Why not? In India, we have our own payment gateway system, and when it was built, you know what happened? MasterCard and others went running to the US Department of Commerce to say, please stop them from doing this because our monopoly on gateway systems will be impacted. Sachin referenced this when he talked about SWIFT. Why do we give our power to others when we can create our own? And these technologies can allow us to do it. So central banks, for example, met to talk about Facebook's Libra, cryptocurrency. Stop it. We don't want these companies to come together to again control our financial systems. Create our own. Maybe there should be a South Asia collaborative network, but it doesn't matter. Do your own thing. Prepare your own solutions. Your own society has needs which the Western companies will not understand. They will have to depend on us, so we've got to do that. One small point on labor and disruption, which I think has been, again, talked about a lot. We should also realize that, you know, this whole piece about white collar and blue collar worker, I think, again, is rooted in a very couple of centuries ago, that all of us with white collars will sit and manage and the rest of them will do the dirty work. Why did they have blue collars? Because it would get dirty. So you didn't want a white shirt to get dirty, so you put a color of blue because, you know, the dirt doesn't show on the blue collar, right? That's a fundamental concept. The difference between white and blue collar is disappearing. We should not even want to have this category of blue collars. Everybody should have equal access to opportunity. So I think we have to look at those points. If automation takes away some people, let's get them to do something else. If nothing else, think of universal basic income, which is another debate we should have, in, you know, which is a parallel debate to the impact of automation.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Would you like to?
I think one of the key examples that my fellow panelists from Mass Holding, she mentioned, I think challenges to scale these good examples up. I think across the region, more and more companies, if they follow your example, the how do we scale it up is then again a big question. I mean, you're doing it, other companies need to do too. Sachin mentioned about the government leading the role of innovation and research. Okay, fine, but at the same time, if the private sector is not brought up in the or involved in the process of the consultation, I think that could lead to some problems. So that is why I suggest a strong public-private dialogue mechanism be established for the 4IR agenda in each individual countries. I have seen in our country that for basic policy reform agenda, for business, it seemed to have worked. So that could be an example that we could take. The example of the infrastructure being put in place already by the A2I initiative of Bangladesh government, since the infrastructure was basically set up for government service, e-government service delivery, and we have a massive penetration of telecommunications, mobile telephony, more than 100 million subscribers in Bangladesh, we should use these platforms effectively so that we can get some benefits from the 4IR perspective as well. Those would be my suggestions.
Thank you very much. Tehani, that leaves you to take the final
comment. Maybe comment very quickly. I think to Asif's point on how easily can these be scaled, that's definitely a problem to solve, and it's something we're looking to solve for. But I think in all of these things, you have to take a very long-term view and be able to stay the game in the long term. And I think that is going to be part of the fourth industrial revolution overall. I think, Randhula, to your point where you said, you know, who is driving it? I think also the question is, what role does everyone play in this equation? And I think it's a trifactor interaction here. You have the private sector, which can be corporates, you can be VCs, like you're involved in, etc. You can have academia, which can really be the research engine where you invest in greenfield technology, and that's where you can take the risk. And then you have government, as Dr. Wijewardena says, the facilitator, to really create the ecosystem and the culture to make this interaction work. And I think that is what's important. The second underlying theme, which I think many people mentioned here, is collaboration. I think we live in an economy and in a world where we think, you know, we work in silos, we benefit ourselves, and I think that mindset has to break. And how do we collaborate and how do we incentivize that to make that meaningful is probably just my thoughts on this.
Thank you. Thank you, Tehani. With that, I open the floor to the audience, but a question to ponder on as we go on with the Q&As. Are we all speaking the same language at this platform? We have academia, we have private sector, we have public sector. Are we all speaking the language of 4IR? With that, I open the audience for questions. Please identify yourself, and also it would be great if you can direct the question to a particular panelist so that it's easy to moderate. I think Anush has... Go for it, Anush.
Thanks, Randhula, and thank you to all the panelists for a very insightful session so far. Some of the things I agree and not others, but that's a conversation over tea. Two very specific questions, one to Pranjal and one to Tehani, and probably the second one is to both Tehani and Mr. Wijewardena. Pranjal, you talked briefly about the need to curb or contain monopolistic behavior around data. My question to you specifically is, how do we do that in a context where a lot of the people, a lot of the firms that hold data are very transboundary in nature? We are recipients of those business models, we are users, we are consumers, we are sometimes the products of those business models, not just the consumer. South Asian countries, governments, we are not really part of those conversations around like what's happening in the EU and the US around breaking down these monopolies, the kind of cases that are being filed. So, you know, it's easy to say we need to be mindful and curb these monopolistic behavior, but I guess the question is, what can countries like ours in South Asia really do, given that many of these are transboundary in nature? What has to change in our approach to that? Second quick question to both Tehani and Mr. Wijewardena. A lot of the evidence coming out around innovative societies and ecosystems is that it really hinges on managerial capability. This whole old idea that it's R&D inputs and, you know, that kind of stuff really doesn't matter now, because 4IR and digital, as was covered today, allows anyone to do new things. But it hinges hugely on managerial capability. Not everyone is like Lakmini, not every company has folks like Tehani, or, you know, companies like MAS that are thinking very innovatively, thinking several steps ahead, going completely changing their business models. My question to both of you, one from a company perspective and one from Mr. Wijewardena's macro perspective, is how do we achieve that at scale? How do we make sure, who plays the role in making sure more firms at all sizes and at all ages have that capability to innovate? Whose role is it to instill that? Does government have a role? Is it larger firms working with smaller firms? Who's going to do that? Because that's going to be a big determinant of whether this can happen at scale or not.
Thank you, Anush.
So, you know, there are two levels to this. One, You can see the fight back happening led by Europe, and I think that's fantastic, the way they have challenged the American technology giants. I think that's showing the way for individual countries to fight. You know, the right to be forgotten. Google has won that lawsuit, but only, you know, it's won it to the extent that the right to be forgotten is valid in Europe only. Now it's up to all of us. Each of the countries in South Asia or other parts of the world should sue Google and say, I want a right to be forgotten. So each country, sovereign countries, have the right. Trust me, I know government officials, and in each of your countries, every government has a simple switch, literally, to switch off Google in that country. So the government still has a lot of power. Please don't assume that government cannot shut off Google or Facebook in your country. It is possible. It can happen in 30 seconds. So government has to use that power, wield it wisely, point A. So if you put up enough threats with reason, it will happen. Second point is about the second level of competition. So I gave you the example of payment systems. Payment wallets, for instance, make sure there are many companies doing it. You know, if you look at other questions for this government in India, and I'm sure in other South Asian countries, are forcing some of these digital companies to be physically present. So physical corporatization of their entity is important. WhatsApp was existing in India for several years. It didn't have a representative. So the government of India said, you've got to set up, it's a different company, it may be owned by Facebook, but it is separate entity globally. I want a company to be established. I want a person who's accountable to what's going on. Same is going on with TikTok. So you then ensure that there is certain accountability, which all of us have referred to, for all these digital companies. Once there is accountability, you can contain them and control them and ensure that they work within a fair play system.
Thank you, Pranjal. Tehani, if you'd like to take on Anush's next question.
I think, Anush, you had two questions there, which I'm going to try and frame, so I respond accurately. One is how you build that managerial capability, and then whose role is it to build the overall environment that you work in? I think that's a tough question in how you build managerial capability. At MAS, we've been blessed with a visionary chairman who's driven it top down. But I think very early on in our innovation journey, we understood the need to be able to drive innovation into the very DNA of our business so it becomes culture. But there have been challenges in that. And the reason is that we didn't always make the connect, even though the innovation team had that mantra, we didn't always make the connect between defining the problem statement and defining the business case to say, this is why you need to do it. If not, you won't survive. And I think driving that mindset is a journey. But I feel like today, compared to 5 years ago when MAS looks at itself, all our CEOs are talking about, we need innovation because we are not going to survive if not. So I think that journey is something that we need to take, and I think it's a cultural dynamic, and companies really need to invest in understanding who are the key stakeholders and how do we convert them. I think the second piece of it is also in whose role is it, just overall, when you look at an ecosystem. And I think there's a huge role to play in terms of harnessing the collective strength of the startup community. And I think there's more work to be done for that in Sri Lanka, because I feel startups always challenge the status quo. It is hard to say that monopolies will exist in perpetuity, because you always have a wild card coming in and disrupting the market. Today you can debate that the unicorns are succeeding, and that's a different conversation. But I think you have to create the culture, the investment, the support, the ecosystem to let those startups come and disrupt the way we think of core business. And I really think government playing a facilitating role in that and supporting that. And Singapore is doing that quite effectively. The Valley has done it for many years now. I think that is a key engine to really spur that change going forward. Thank you, Tehani.
Anushka, we can get some lessons from Malaysia, which was preparing itself to face this particular situation. What it did was, it took the private sector people and the government sector people into a retreat and kept them in for 3 months in isolation. They were asked to come up with the program to take Malaysia out of the middle income trap. this happened about, say, 3 years ago, and to take notice of the emerging technologies in the world and what Malaysia should do. And what they did was, they actually, after they came out of the retreat, they signed off. Private sector businessmen and the government sector bureaucrat, they signed it off, and therefore it was a one voice, and they introduced it across the country. So similar things should happen in a country like Sri Lanka. Now we must take the private sector people like Lakmini to retreat for 3 months, and at the same time take the Secretary, Minister of Finance also to a retreat, and let them identify the problem that we are facing and the critical nature of the problem and come up with the solutions, and let them sign off whatever they determine jointly. And this is the way to move forward for Sri Lanka.
Thank you, Dr. Wijewardena. I think we have two questions from the audience pending from the last time. One at the back, you can go first, and then at the front. We'll carry both questions and then directly to the audience.
I don't want to monopolize. Thank you for providing the opportunity. I don't want to monopolize on the question of monopoly, actually. You know, this is something that I wanted to jump in on, and then so that Pranjal could have responded to that question. See, I mean, it's not a simple solution, because we've talked about data. But at the same time, we have to be aware of the fact that intellectual property protection, and this is something that Mustafa has also raised this morning, intellectual property protection on 4IR technologies are heavily concentrated. You know, a study by European Patent and Trademark Office conducted in 2017 shows that out of 48,000 patents that were granted patent protection, innovation, that were granted patent protection in European Union, 90% of them were filed by companies in 5 jurisdictions: the European Union, USA, China, Japan, and Korea. Mm. That's one problem. The other problem is that most of these startups are being taken over and acquired by big giants. And it's not, it doesn't have to be a high profile, but then I just give you a data. Between 2013 and 2017, 300 startup, relatively mid-sized startup, have been taken over by 5 companies such as Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon, Intel, Microsoft, Meltwater, and Twitter. So there's a kind of concentration that is happening, and that's going to affect us. We are already, you know, in a way left behind, and that's going to affect us. But then the jurisdiction, which can, you know, as you mentioned, Pranjal, and this is my question to you, is that just switching off is probably not the option. You have to follow due process. And due process can be followed only when you have a domestic competition legislation which requires several states to be sort of, you know, to be followed before switching off, right? So that threat can work in some cases. In some other cases, it may not work. For the size of the market, India is a big market, China is a big market, they want to switch off, you know, Google will worry about that.
But China Nepal wants to, you know that.
Yeah, China has already done that, Google will worry about that. But, you know, if Nepal or Sri Lanka or Maldives want to do that, then, you know, that's a different story. So what I am actually suggesting here, and then would like to hear from the panels about this, you know, is that, you know, should there be a global architecture on competition which could, you know, tame the potential monopolistic and oligopolistic behavior so as to reduce the market power of these firms?
Thank you. Pranjal, before you take the question, we have a pending question from the previous round which I would like to take, and then we'll take it on.
Thank you, Honorable Chair, for giving me the opportunity. This is Sarwar from A2I Bangladesh. We know 4IR technologies can be an enabler for to leapfrog a country's development or economic growth, and it can also help for exponential development. And in this journey, the private sector like Lakmini or other innovators can also part to contribute. But unfortunately, like Bangladesh or probably many other countries in South Asia, we haven't that kind of ecosystem where private sector, government, industry can work together or go together. So my question probably goes to Professor Sachin Chaturvedi. What could be the role of civil society for creating that kind of ecosystem, innovation ecosystem, where both industry, private and public partnership can work together? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your question, Pranjal.
Right. Let me answer that. Nobody should monopolize conversations on monopoly. That's a great point, Ratnakar. First, I think, yes, competition law has to be improved. There's no question about it. The way you define competition from 50 years ago to 30 years ago to today, that competition itself and what is fair play, what is a market, what is overbearing dominance on a market, those definitions have exploded. Every single function that we do, you know, messaging can be a market by itself. So there's no question about it. We have to reinvent our systems and laws to reflect what's going on. So for example, we've had a drone policy which was announced in India in 2018, 1st of December. And drone policy says that now you cannot just fly any drone anywhere. A drone operator has to get the same kind of license that a pilot in a plane needs to have. If you don't have line of sight, you cannot fly that drone, right? So it's an example of a completely new law and legislative structure which is reflecting a new reality. Similarly, we need these kind of laws. Now, competition is example. On IPR, and I think it's important what you mentioned, one reason, and I'm not saying it's the only reason why 95% of what you said is in five jurisdictions is because in our countries, and I'm including South Asia and Asia, our IPR laws are terrible. We have not made them modern enough, A, and we have not made them open enough. A lot of companies, I can speak for companies in India, if they want to register an IP, they go to Singapore. They don't do it in India. Why? Because they feel unsafe in India, or they feel the process is so terrible and non-dynamic that the guy sitting behind the counter don't understand what they're trying to register. So whose fault is that? It's our fault. So we cannot blame the jurisdictions of US because they are doing it. You will be surprised if you do further studies. I'm sure somebody will find this occasion that a lot of the IPR registered in these countries are from companies based in our part of the world. Why is that happening? So we need to fix that before we go to it. On the global architecture, yes, I think we need a global architecture, but with due respect to WTO and WIPO, it should not be done by these multilateral agencies, which have been severely compromised over the years. I think it has to come from an Asian perspective. We have to do it and create something. TRIPS and TRIMS were written by lawyers for big pharma and big technology companies of those days, and I'm sure a lot of you know that. The new global architecture has to be rooted in an Asian context, specifically in South Asia.
Thank you, Pranjal. Sachin, there was a question.
Yes, I would just say in one line, I think civil society would have to play an extremely important role, and I count think tanks as part of that process. They would have to understand the, as the panel very rightly observed, the dynamics of technology, its imperatives, and the gravitas that it brings into public policy making. So governments, the other actors would have to be informed, the consumers would have to be informed, there are privacy-related issues, and n number of dimensions with which public policy would have to confront, so civil society would have to play a very important role.
Thank you very much. I would like to, love to keep talking with such a lively, dynamic panel here with me and such an interactive audience, but I'm saddened to say we'll have to close. Thank you very much for being a part of this platform and discussion. And to close with, I think we take home the message that be it private sector, public sector, or academia, or whichever silo that we are caught up with, we need to approach the topic of OIR with an open mind and also without wearing the shaded frames we are all wearing to be able to collaborate and really leapfrog together, because only to innovate and innovate fast, we can only do it together. Absolutely. Thank you very much. Have a very pleasant evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I would love to let you monopolize the time and continue speaking. Unfortunately, I had to regulate you. So can we please have a warm round of applause for the plenary session and the entire panel, as well as our moderator, for a wonderful discussion over the past 1.5 years. I have been asked to announce that there will be a launch of an EIF-UN-SCAP joint project on e-commerce capacity building for women-led SMEs in South Asia in the Moonstone Room from 5 p.m. onwards. Those who want to join over are most welcome. Now, to conclude the South Asia Economic Summit, and I cordially invite Dr. Dushni Veerakoan, Executive Director of IPS Sri Lanka.
Thank you, Keith Mina. It's been a, I think, innovative 2 days of discussions that we've had. I was telling some of my colleagues during lunch that we have got through 2 days at a South Asia Economic Summit without our usual phrase of saying South Asia is the least integrated region in the world, and I take that as that we have, in some sense, we tend to focus backwards and reflect on all the failings, but at this two-day event, we've been looking to the future. And I think that the discussions and deliberations that we've had, to me, highlights two things. One, clearly, is that there is enormous interest in moving forward the agenda on the fourth industrial revolution, what it means for the future of South Asia in all these different elements that we discussed through the different sessions of this summit. Second is that given that wide interest, I think there is significant scope for joint and collaborative efforts for us to take this discussion forward. At the IPS, what we will be doing is putting together a series of blocks on the plenary and the parallel session discussions that we've had. Our blocks tend to be picked up by the media and do get wide publicity. I would also welcome any contributions from our participants related to the sessions that were covered in the summit itself, but even work that you may have done related to some of the issues that were discussed. What does 4IR mean for our labor markets? What does it mean for the future of work? What does it mean for the way that we will live and interact with each other? Any research or thoughts that have already been that you have produced, we can also carry in order to continue this discussion. When we decided to focus the 12th South Asia Economic Summit on the issue of the fourth industrial revolution, and our research team started to do some background work, we realized that there's very limited work out there. We've started looking at this at the national level. What does the fourth industrial revolution mean for Sri Lanka's economic future? But I think there is a lot to be learned through more collaborative efforts. Clearly, some countries are ahead of us in terms of the regulatory and other aspects. Others are behind some of the South Asian countries in terms of even the labor market developments, and cross experiences, I think, is the reason why this collaborative economic summit was initiated 12 years ago. So I would really urge anyone that has any interest in working on any of these issues to please do get in touch with us, and we will network and coordinate from our end. So I'm not going to take long to extend the final sort of closing session or attempt to summarize the many issues that were touched on over the last 2 days. It's been a fairly long program, and everybody must be waiting to have some time to rest and relax before you start on your return journey. But before closing the session, I have the pleasant duty of extending our thanks to some of our key players in organizing this summit. First, let me start by thanking our SAES partners, CPD Bangladesh, RIS India, SAUTI Nepal, and SDBI Pakistan. I would like to express my sincere thanks to all the heads of the four institutions for their commitment to be in Colombo and to bring their colleagues along with them. Our thanks also to the sponsors of the 12th SAES, the World Bank, ADB, Swiss Embassy in Colombo, the Commonwealth Secretariat, UNESCO Delhi Office, and the Asia Foundation. I thank all our resource persons, the more than 55 or so foreign participants who joined us, and our Sri Lankan experts and resource persons who engaged with us in this process. The summit would not have been as successfully conducted without your engagement and participation. And to the many participants who joined us in the last 2 days, we had a full house when we inaugurated the summit, and though many of us expected the participation to drop as we went along, I'm very pleased to see that those who signed on to attend did do so. So thank you for your active participation. My thanks all to logistics, to the Hilton Hotel. They've been very helpful, and my hope that IPS team will also convey my personal thanks to the hotel management. There is only the final very pleasant task, and that is for me to thank my own colleagues at the IPS who were actively involved in organizing this. So if the members of the organizing committee are here, please stand up and be counted. From the research staff, Nipuli, Kitmina, and Nuanti. From our events manager, Charmaine, and her team, Naomi and Natasha. Communications, Shihara. IT, Nalaka and Nandaka. And our finance team, Gayani, who is not here, but I think some of her colleagues are here, and all the other IPS staff members who coordinated the sessions and helped in numerous ways, comparing, etc. My very sincere thanks to Janaka, who led the organization of the 12th South Asia Economic Summit, and by a happy coincidence, it is also his birthday today. We had a team of very engaged and... So, happy birthday, Janaka. It was a little late.
And may all your dreams come true.
Happy, happy birthday.
And by a very happy coincidence, I must also say that Janaka was the SAES team who led the first 2008 organization committee at IPS. So he's a veteran of this SAES process. And I am very, very thankful and grateful to him for giving leadership to the IPS team on this. We had some very enthusiastic and helpful set of volunteers who helped us over the last 2 days and a week or so leading up to this. I hope they are in the room or they are still running around. You must have seen them outside. Our thanks also to those interns who volunteered for the SAES. My final duty is to call on our next host for the 13th South Asia Economic Summit. I take great pleasure in inviting Sachin Chaturvedi, Director General of RIS India, who will take the baton from here.
Good, you have to be there. Be here. Thank you, Dushni. And congratulations at the outset for excellent and very successful organization of the South Asia Economic Summit. I think we have last 2 days, seamless flow of four IR, and I think the impact that we had with Janaka's birthday, I think is marvelous. Congratulations, Janaka, for doing this hard work on your birthday. I don't think if anybody should have birthday on a day when you are so much engaged in such a big group. But congratulations to you for putting hard work together. I think every time we are putting South Asia Economic Summit together, the bar is going up and up. And I'm sure RIS and RIS partner institutions would do everything when we meet next year to have that higher standard taking forward further. So congratulations, and I look forward working with you in New Delhi next summit.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Come. Okay. So for all our foreign participants, we hope that you have a safe and pleasant journey back. IPS colleagues will be around to assist you. If there is any administrative issues, please do contact us. Thank you very much.